Good morning. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord? Isn't it good to be here today? Well, that's a little tepid. I say it's great to be in God's house today. Okay, all right. Sincerely, it is. It's good to see you. I'm so glad you're here, and a little bit of weather, ups and downs, but all considered, faring pretty well. Could be much worse. So hopefully this will be a measure of what's yet to come. Won't be too bad. But we're so glad you're here. On the round table in the back are pew pads. And so we encourage you. I know I can't tell you what to do, but please avail yourself of that. There also are contribution statements. It's in the bulletin, well, in the gathering area. Please take the statements for you and your family today, if you would. And any other announcements to make or to highlight? Any other? If not, would you stand together with me for the call to worship and lead into our opening hymn of praise? Chose Psalm 33, verse 18 to 22. But the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him, in those whose hope is in his unfailing love, to deliver them from death and keep them alive in famine. We wait in hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In him our hearts rejoice, for we trust in his holy name. May your unfailing love rest upon us, O Lord, even as we put our hope in you. As you're standing, as God's blessing of his word, may we join in our hymn of praise. I owe for 1,000 tongues to sing. Sit, remain standing, do a little different. Any praises today? Any joyful expressions of what God has done this week? Any joys? Yes, yes, Penny. Wonderful. Yes, good news. Thank the Lord. Yes, amen. I'll go ahead, Joy. Okay. Yeah. Amen. Okay. I have a different take, but that's okay. That's me. And I'll step ahead. It's a joy. Mike expressed this morning, Trudy had a good week. The chemo and So that's good. That's wonderful, good news. So we thank the Lord so much for that. Amen. Yes. I was at the doctor's and this week, and I'm still kicking. So he says I'm doing very well. Yeah. He didn't need to tell me that. I thought I'm doing okay. Yeah. But anyway, so I do thank the Lord. Yes. Amen. Well, thank you. God inhabits the praises of his people, doesn't he? So you may be seated. At this time, we'll gather for the giving of our tithes and offerings. Our loving Father, we thank you through the Lord Jesus Christ, our wonderful Savior. In his name, we are privileged people. Thank you for the joy that we experience and have one with another, and even greater and much more higher with you. Thank you for these moments this morning, for each one as we return a portion back to you. We lift these gifts today to your blessing, that you will mete it out and for all your intended purpose, in Jesus' precious name, amen. You may be seated. Oh, for 1,000 tongues to sing, or I should say, the power of God. Yeah, I sing the mighty power of God. Thank you. Much Joyce, Greg, Brittany, John, great to have you today. Yeah, trust you and Vicki are doing well, and it's good to see you as always. Thank you. And Jason, thank you. He'll soon be Postmaster General.
No.
I said Postmaster General or he's Gopher.
Nah, thank you, Jason.
In prayer today, we'd ask you to remember the McCoy family. Brad's stepmom passed away this week, and so remember the McCoy family. Remember Calvin. Calvin's, should say, Cindy left a message that Calvin was not doing well. Not sure if it's COVID, but he's not doing well. So remember Calvin this morning. And Joyce said today, Crystal's having a difficult time. Larry's declining, not doing well. And so remember Larry Reber today. Laura Hartman, we've been praying for her. She's having surgery. I believe it's still set for the 21st of this month. So next week, be having surgery in Pittsburgh. We continue, remember, for Trudy, and as already explained, good news. She had a good week. And so we continue our prayers for her. For Betty Sterner and Tammy for cancer, Jane Pritz and Jennifer. As we mentioned, Madeline is doing much better. And remember, I asked you to continue to pray each day for Peggy Kimmel. And remember Kelly for her back issues. Alan Schaefer stopped in to church this week, and he and Julie, their daughter Trish, will be having a biopsy. So remember Trish at this time as they move through to make decisions and get more definite of where she's at with that. Are there others to add this morning? I know our list seems to grow. Yes.
Just an update, we've been praying for Dolly Fergus. She actually passed away this week.
Okay.
That's my future son-in-law's grandmother.
Okay.
And an update on my husband, Dan. He had having some stiffness in his back last couple of days, which is causing him some discomfort. So just continue prayers for him that he can work this out.
Yes, Kelly.
Ask for prayers for Mitchell. He was in a hockey game yesterday.
Oh, no.
Broke his lap.
Oh. Oh, yes, John.
The BJ Meyer family, BJ passed away this past week. And also the Byron family, Rick Byron, Larry Byron, their mother and their sister also passed away yesterday morning. So keep that in your prayers.
The mother passed away. Well, at this time, if we could, let's join together in prayer. Our Father, we thank you as we once again come into your presence. We know that you are ever with us every moment of every day. You're the God that neither slumbers nor sleeps. We are the ones that we continue to put our hope in you every day. We look to you with heart's desire for the best. And as we think today, we asked you to be with Deanne and Brad and the family, continue to bring a renewed sense of your presence and your word to ring in their hearts as they move through with separation and loss and real sorrow. But we know that you're there with them, and you'll gird their emotions and everything and help them each day that they'll find the strength and the emotional fortitude. But we know it's at the low, and as it should be. But it will move through, and there will be greater confidence and greater sense of hope but we remember them today, that you'll hold them and carry them through these days. As been shared, we'll, for the B.J. Maurer family, for the Barron family, that you'll be with them, for Dolly Fergus and the family, for her passing. We pray that you'll be tender with them and grant them the strength they need and your presence that will be there for each respective. We know in these times it's just so very difficult. Remember those with cancer, as we've mentioned, that Father, that you know each and every one, you know the stage they're at. We pray especially as we remember each day and this morning for Trudy. Thank you, Lord, for giving her renewed strength and that as the chemo treatments proceed and move, that Father, that even though there is some things that she faces, we know that we hold her together, and we know that utmost, not only our prayers and support and our all that we provide is just so small compared to what you can do, but it all is part, and we love her dearly, and just thank you for the good news this week. May it continue, and may that tumor shrink. May she be cancer free. We believe that you're the same yesterday, today, and forever, and there's nothing impossible with you. And so we look to you and hold on to that. So give many positive outcomes, even this coming week and the weeks that follow. We look to you because you're a faithful God, and we thank you. We rejoice today just for the answers to prayer and the joys expressed. We remember Kelly, and we remember Mitchell, and for Dan, and that you will attend to the different varied things that they're facing. And Lord, strengthen Mitchell and help him that this won't be a long process, but we pray that that we'll mend up and that you'll give him the patience and all that he needs and with the injury. We remember Lauren and her family. We know that that she faces another surgery. We thank you that it was approved, and we just pray this week that you'll be with her and the team of doctors and all that they're going to do. We pray that it will be a safe outcome. We remember Anna as she's having difficulty with some issues, and it's affecting school. So we remember Anna, and we trust that Bruce is doing well with work and all of that. Just be with them as there's some things that come in, but we know that as they look to you, that you'll find that way and that light at the end of the tunnel, so to speak. Grant them blessing. Remember Larry today, and give Crystal all she needs as she's having a difficult time, and pray that things are subsiding and a little more calm, and whatever the issues Larry's facing now, we trust that hopefully in these moments now they've passed of being severe, and we trust that you're holding him very close, and help both this wonderful couple together. We certainly remember today for our community, for our nation, for all those serving. We pray this week as we look towards, and we know there are so many, just so much surrounding and so much information. So we remember for positive outcome and calmness and peace will reign supreme. We thank you this day as we continue to look to you and open your word. Lord, bless your word. Through your Holy Spirit, truly is the teacher, the one who comes alongside. And may you light your word. May there be something that will encourage as well as maybe challenge and help us to grow closer and more deeper with you. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. If you have your Bibles, would you turn to Isaiah chapter 6, Isaiah chapter 6. And for the reading of the scripture today, verses 1 through 5, and asked you to stand together. And I think all of you are pretty well familiar that the bulletins are outlines, and they're just simply a means for you to interact with us as we go through the message today. And as you interact, we're going to take a key text, and we'll read it out loud and together. Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 through 5. Let us share God's word together. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord, high and exalted, seated on the throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphim, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces. With two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried, "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among the people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King." Question is, how big is he? I believe that he's big enough, as we saw last week, to keep you secure, to give you assurance, even in an unsafe world. And today we want to answer the question, what happens when we see God? What do we do in face when we do see God? And so to answer that question, I want to bring to you an old story. Say it's a true story of a young boy, 10 years old, by the name of Timothy. And it's entitled, Why I Believe in God. You may have seen it in literature, devotionals, but let me share it once again if you are familiar with it. Timothy said, and I think it's a gem, it's beautiful, Why I Believe in God. Timothy says, one of God's main jobs is making people. It's a little lengthy, so listen carefully. One of God's main jobs is making people, to put in the place of the ones that die so that there will be enough people to take care of the things here on earth. Make grown-ups, just babies. I think because they are smaller and easier to make. That way he doesn't have to take up his valuable time teaching them how to talk and walk. He can just leave that up to mothers and fathers, and I think that works out pretty well. God's second most important job is listening to prayers. An awful lot of this goes on as some people, like preachers, pray other times than besides bedtime. God doesn't have time to listen to the radio or TV on account of this. I see as he hears everything, not only prayers, but there must be terrible lot of noise going on in his ears unless he thought of a way to turn it off. God sees everything. He hears everything and is everywhere, which keeps him pretty busy. So you shouldn't go wasting his time by going over your parents' head and asking him for something that you shouldn't do. I think a parent snuck that in there, don't you think? Timothy says atheists are people who don't believe in God. I don't think there are any in my town. At least there aren't any that come to my church. Some theology there, I think. Timothy says Jesus is God's son. He used to do all the hard work, like walking on water, doing miracles, trying to teach people about God who didn't want to learn. They finally got tired of his preaching to them, and they crucified him. But he was good and kind like his father. And he told his father that they did not know what they were doing and to forgive them. And God said, okay. His dad appreciated everything that he had done and all his hard work on earth. So he told him that he didn't have to go out on the road anymore and that he could stay in heaven, and so he did. And now he helps his father out by listening to prayers and seeing which things are important for God to take care of and which ones he can take care of himself without having to bother God. God is like a secretary. Oh, well, only more important, of course. You can pray anytime you want, and they're sure to hear you because they got it all worked out so that one of them is on duty all the time. You should always go to Sunday school because going to Sunday school makes God happy. And if there's anybody that you want to make happy, it's God. So don't skip Sunday school and do something you think would be more fun, like going to the beach. That is wrong. And besides, the sun doesn't come out on the beach until noon. And if you don't believe in God, besides being an atheist, you'll be very lonely because your parents can't go everywhere with you like to camp, but God can. It's good to know that he's around when you are scared of the dark or when you can't swim very well and you get thrown into the real deep water by the big kids. But you shouldn't always just think of what God can do for you. I figure God put me here, and he can take me back anytime he pleases. And that's why I believe in God. I thought that's beautiful. Happy couple come home from the hospital. They have their brand new little baby boy. They put him in the crib, and they leave the bedroom, and the little brother comes in, snuck into the room, and comes to the crib and looks over his new little baby brother and looks in and says, "Little baby brother, before you forget, tell me what God looks like." So what does God look like? You know, people will be longing to want to know what God looks like. Well, that's what we want to answer today. What does God look like? What happens when we really see God? Well, there are two pictures here in Isaiah chapter 6. We're going to begin with the latter first, and then we'll finish up on why we need to see God clearly. How do you see God clearly? So we'll take the latter part. But the two pictures are, first of all, people see God and people who do not see God. Isaiah saw God, and the children of Israel did not see God. Those two pictures are clear, and they're no different than today. There's people that see God, and there's people who do not see God. And so that's what we're simply. It's a simple lesson, and so we want to look at first why do not people see God clearly? Well, first of all is rebellion against God. Rebellion. I can mark it down. If there are people that rebel against God, they don't believe there is a God. They don't believe that God is interested in their life. Mark it down. They're not going to see God. And hopefully today that you do see God in that. But there are obstacles. There are things in the way. But in the broad scheme of things across the world, there is so much they don't see God in there, whether rebellion, whether God's not interested in them. So if you feel today God interested or he doesn't care for you or some way, you won't see it either. Notice in Isaiah in here, he says, "Go tell the people, be ever hearing but never understanding, be ever seeing but never perceiving." In here, "Make the hearts of this people callous, make their ears dull and close their eyes. Otherwise they might see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and turn and be healed." Isaiah is talking to people that God said, tell the children of Israel, as he preaches to them, as he begins to interact with them, that all that he is saying to them, what's the response? They are shutting their eyes and they're closing their ears. They're rejecting all the goodness that God has for them. Are there any today that do that? That they shut their eyes and they close their ears? And God in some way in here is saying, and that would be an awful thing for anybody that brings God's word or to in Sunday school or teaching or preaching, is to a group of people that you know when you're preaching, they're shutting their eyes and they're closing their ears. That would not be any fun. And that's who God is sending Isaiah to preach to. They have rebelled against God, that God is wanting to bring them. And the result and consequence further is, Isaiah says, how long? How long are these people going to shut their eyes and close their ears on that? And he says, until the cities lie in ruin and without inhabitant, and houses are left desolate, and fields ruined and ravaged, until the Lord has sent everyone far away, and the land is utterly forsaken. That's a dismal picture, isn't it? Will that happen to any nation? Well, that's what we won't answer it now, but just think, a seed thought. As we move up through our series, there are some things that may be in stark contrast to your thinking. The second, I think, is not only rebellion against God, because they had sinned against God, and God knew that they sinned on purpose. You see, sin is rejecting and going against the known will of God. In some way, people say, well, I'm not responsible for this, and I didn't really do this, and, they try to work around it, but most know that they sin. The people of the children of Israel, they sinned, and God knew, and Isaiah knew that as well. The second is, that I don't know if you think of it in this light, is when you put God in a box. When you put God in a place that this is how he only answers and he only works and he only does things. Do you put God in a box? You see, regarding the insecurities of mankind, people do put God in a box. They put a label on God. They file him away somewhere where they can, you know, understand him readily. They can use him at the moment they need him. They see him in only this light. But God doesn't operate in a box. If you put God in here and you put a label and say, well, here he is, and I'm going to go this way in life, you're going to have difficult times, right? God doesn't operate in a box. The story so vivid of putting God in a box is the story of Naaman. In 2 Kings chapter 5, just a summation of that story. Naaman was the captain of the Syrian army. And he had a little servant girl who was Jewish in his home. And one day she said to him, she said, Captain Naaman, if you would go to my homeland, we have a prophet by the name of Elisha, that if you go to him, and because Naaman was a leper, he had leprosy. And Naaman, the Syrian, the army, the little Jewish girl said, if you'll go to our homeland, there's Elisha, and you go to him and you ask of him and pray to God, you can be healed of that. And so Naaman went down with his entourage down to Elisha's home. And in verse 11, in here, verse 10 in here, the messenger said to him, go to the Jordan and dip in the Jordan River seven times, and when you come out, you'll come out clean as a baby. It says in here that Naaman said, I thought. And in verse 15, Naaman said, I now know that there is no God in all the earth but in Israel. Now, what's the difference between verse 11 and verse 15? Between I know, or I thought, and now I know there's no God in all the earth but in Israel. You see, when he went to Elisha's home and the messenger come out, he was troubled by it. He was furious. He was upset. He was, what can I say, ticked off? Because it's not a, you know, we don't use it so much. I won't say anything more, I really. But he was furious. Why? He said, I thought. He expected Elisha to come out, right? He made this trip, and he thought Elisha would come out. And he was furious that only the messenger come out, because he thought Elisha's going to come out and wave his rod, you know, like Moses, and wave his hand and pray a deep prayer, a deep voice. Because, you know, God doesn't hear you unless you have a deep voice. That's what some people say. But that didn't happen. The way that he thought God would operate didn't go. The messenger came out and says, go to the Jordan. But I believe he thought even more deeply, don't you think? That when the messenger said, go down to the Jordan, dip in seven times, and you will be healed of your leprosy. You see, he turned back. He didn't go initially. His entourage urged him to go. Because here's what I think he thought. He thought, why would I go down to the muddy Jordan and dip in that muddy river when I've got pools in Syria that are clean? Why do I have to go down there? That's what he thought. Have you ever thought like that? You know, you're believing God's wanting you to do this. And you say, well, I could just do it. Why do I have to? Because God said so. God said that's the only way to be healed. You got to go to the Jordan River, not to the pools in Syria. And you got to do it seven times. It's kind of wild, isn't it? It doesn't make sense. But his entourage encouraged him strongly. And so he went to the Jordan, he dipped in seven times, and he came completely healed. It's an example between verse 11 and verse 15, between I thought and now I know there is no God in all the earth but in Israel. Do you? think. And you know God is saying this is, and you got to trust him on that. See, Naaman put God in a box. He thought this is the only way that God works. This only way. But God is a diverse God. He's not going to be limited by your operation or your manners or what you do. So for example, you know, God, I believe God speaks to me. He speaks, you know, I'll be honest with you. I'll say to you, in all my years thus far, you know, 50 years. Wow, now you, oh, got you now. Yeah. Yeah, Mr. Yoder over there said I lied. But if I hear God tomorrow on Monday morning and say, Ron, I want you to eat a grapefruit. So I eat a grapefruit. And the next day I get up and God says, eat a grapefruit. So I'm going to eat a grapefruit. And I go the third day and I go the fourth day. God, eat a grapefruit. Eat a grapefruit. What do you think I'm going to do? Going to wait to listen to what God says of eat a grape? Wait till he says that or what inspiration I receive? No, I'm pretty well going to believe that God's going to want me to keep eating grapefruits. And that's that concept or idea of putting God in a box. Because he said it this way in the past and he's doing it this way now, then he will do it forever and ever and ever. But that's not so. Sometimes he changes it up. God is an awesome God. And sometimes we do that. But when God is clearly saying that, we've got to follow in that. But we also see God through ourselves, our temperaments, our personalities, how we were raised, our background, don't we? There's a sense that we do that through ourselves. See, in Genesis 1:26, what did it say? Did God say that we are to make ourselves into his image, or he into our image? And what is that called when we take ourselves and we make ourselves a God? When we make ourselves, we change it. What's that called? It's called humanism, isn't it? Is humanism a lost art? Do you hear it today? Oh, no, humanism's all around. It's prevalent in our society. But that struggle where we are not going to see God if we see him only through ourselves, through our temperament in that. You realize there are four temperaments? Every one of you, and some of you may have two. I believe I have two of the temperaments. But there's four of the temperaments. Have you ever heard them? I can look at you and I could tell you now some of you have two, and I could name two of yours because I think I know you well enough now, not all of you. But every one of you have temperaments. And sometimes through those temperaments is how you see God. And it can be different from what is needed. The first of all is, as quickly as I can, is the choleric. The choleric is the strong, bossy type. And they see God is not only in control, but they make definite statements, right? And they are the ones that take the scripture, thou shall have no other gods before you. There's real strong, bossy type. And that can be good and that can be bad. But they see God in the midst of that. But then there is the temperament of the sanguine. And the sanguine verse is that Jesus Christ is once us in that verse, John 10:10, I have come to give life and to give it more abundantly. The sanguine is the one that wants to have fun. They believe that God primarily wants you to be happy. And so they're all invested in having fun and being happy and all of that. They say, God wants us to party. We should enjoy life and enjoy that in life. There's a positive to that, but there's a downside of that, of seeing God only is for you to be happy and to be satisfied and to have everything safe in all respects of your life. They see that. Then there's the phlegmatic. And the phlegmatic sees God as slow and patient in the process. They they see God as slow. They don't see God as a God of getting angry at all or any kind of wrath or judgment. A phlegmatic person, a Christian, will see God as slow in the process. God loves us, and he loves us unconditionally, and he's patient and slow with us through the process. And so they see God, and their verse would be that he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and right? And that's true, he is. But they see him kind of the same, just slow, boring life in the midst of that. There's the good, right? There's the positive of that, and there's the downside. And there's the melancholic person. They see God as in control. God is in control, and a melancholic wants to make sure their life is in control. Everything is as it should be in there. JT, did you see the sparrow? JT, did you see the, I saw the sparrow fall. JT, did you see the sparrow fall? No, JT didn't even see the trees. Why would he see the sparrow fall? I'm teasing you, brother. But that's the melancholic. Yeah, the definite statements. Everything's control, and so that Christian, sometimes Christian come and say, did you know that? That I remember a person in church said that. Did you know what? Did you see that? I said, no, I didn't. You mean you didn't see that? You didn't? I said, no, I didn't see it. I'm sorry. But that's, so there's the good and bad of that. I won't tell you today what I think your temperament is in that, but there's the good and bad of that. And what happens in the midst of that is that the temperaments and background, we can get out of balance. We can get out of balance, and we can, instead of being versatile in things in life, we begin to get out of balance. And then we begin to just view things exclusively. But God is diverse. It's like the old story. The two preachers, one's a black man and the other's a white man. And they're going to a conference. And so as they're driving along, the preacher's driving, and all of a sudden they're debating. And I believe that God is black. And the white preacher says, come on, now you know that God's white. And he goes, no, God is black. And he says, no, God. And so they're going back and forth, they're arguing. And so the preacher that's driving a car wrecks, and they get killed. And they wake up, and they're in heaven. And it's beautiful. And they're walking down the streets of gold, and they go, we're in heaven. Yeah. They look at one another. They said, isn't it beautiful? Oh, it's awesome. Hey, we're here. Now we can find out if what God is. And so they're moving along the streets of gold, and they look up ahead and they see angels, kind of angelic angels hovering over a crowd. And they go, I bet you God's in the midst of that. So they get up close, you know, and as the angels are hovering over and the crowd is gathering around, they get real close, and they get around the corner, and they see God, and he says, Buenos dias. Buenos dias. Now you understand that God is spirit, right? But we have that tendency to see God through our backgrounds, our temperaments, in the midst of it. And then one other, as we answer quickly, is see God through the media. Now I could run... But I just hopefully you see today that you don't get your picture of God through the media, because you're going to get distorted viewpoints. You're going to get difficulty. I think I said a number of weeks ago, I get upset. I don't see that often, but when I see preachers and I see Christians that are pictured as basically donkeys, they show them making donkeys out of themselves. They make them less. And, you know, my wife in the early years of marriage, you know, for the first, you know, what did I say, 11, maybe up to 15 years. Next year will be, or I should say this year will be 34 years, and couldn't have a better helpmate, a better woman in my life. But I remember early in her years, like, she had maybe a little bit elevated view of me. That is possible. She, do you remember, dear? She, you know, maybe when I was, you know, young, you take things much more in it. But she had an elevated view. She called me wrong. And I thought, what? Put me in those movies, right? Where the Christians are as donkeys or the pastor is viewed as wimpy and, you know, all that. Put me in one of those movies, right? Ron Rambo. But now after close to 34 years, I think it's been diminished a little bit. I'm not sure that is there. But you see that so often. But can I say, I could give you a litany of examples. I won't do that. It's not needed. But there's a litany of examples, decade after decade, and even up to this year of 2021. Pam and Joyce know the word dissonance. And when I hear things in the media, how they view God and how they want you to capitulate to their viewpoint or their slant in there, I have dissonance. Right, Pam? You know what dissonance is? It just makes you, you cringe. It's the fingernails on the board, right? It's right in music, that's how I view predominantly across. Sometimes there are truths that come through, but you see, it's cringy to me. I go, no, that is not, why would you bring that? Why would you pontificate theologically when you don't even know? So I could give you examples, even current, where they bring that, and they're absolutely wrong. They don't understand it. They don't know, but they'll bring it out, and people will believe that. But I believe the more you are in God's Word, the more you read God's Word, the more you're grounded, you're going to catch the dissonance. You're going to go, no, that is not in that. We can't do anything against it. What I mean is it's going to cause that. I hope that you get from God's Word. I hope that you, as you're studying, you're going to find that for your life. That's important, that you're grounded, and I believe that's your desire. That's why you're here. That's why you're part of the family of God. You want Christian homes and Christian families, and you want to be grounded that way. That is so vital, and we long for others to do that. So how do we see God clearly? Well, clearly four words. We see it in here, obviously, if you have put it up there, Brittany. First of all, confusion, confession, change, and commitment. They're all in the scripture, verses 1-8. You see, when Isaiah went in the temple and he looked up, there is King Uzziah. And if you know anything about King Uzziah, he ruled for 52 years. So in succinct truth, he was a great king. He had a solid leadership. The nation for 52 years was secure. They had peace. They had calm. The people loved him. He ruled for 52 years. But when Isaiah came into the temple and he looked up, he's no longer there. The one that they put their hope in, the one they put their trust in, the children of Israel, he's not there. They relied on him too strongly. And the even further, not in Isaiah and others, Isaiah looked too greatly to Uzziah. He depended too greatly on him. Because you notice that as we read together the latter part of it, Isaiah said, the true king, the king of heaven and earth. But you see, what the point being is there had to be confusion. You see, sometimes it's not so that the King Uzziah died in our life. It's the fact that those King Uzziah has been taken away from us. There's a true story of a fellow that came to a pastor and said to the pastor, he said, I want to tell you that the story that not only how I found God, but he says how I lost my marriage. He says, I was not a Christian. I didn't believe in God, didn't want everything, but my wife did. And I did things that weren't right to my wife. But I lost my marriage. I lost my wife and family. But he said, during Easter time, he says, I wanted to tell her that I found God, that I found her. But she was in another state, and she's happy. Everything is fine. But it took me 4 days to locate and find her. And in my search, I found her and I told her, I found God. I needed to tell her that. Let me ask you, when did his search begin? When did his search begin? When he lost his marriage. I'm just using an example. It could be anything else. But sometimes out there, the searches that people have, nothing is going to change sometimes until there's confusion, until there's something that comes in there. His search began there. And for others, it can be something else. And maybe for you, when you first were searching God, sometimes confusion can be a good thing because it causes us to begin to search and to find God in the midst of it. And quickly through, obviously, confession, because the moment he confessed, he realized that, said, woe is me, I'm ruined, I'm unclean, I'm undone in the midst of it. And he confessed it, and when the confession came, then he began to change. Once he confessed, once he acknowledged, he began to change. And sometimes the truth of the matter is that we don't change until we hurt enough that we have to change. And sometimes when we pray for people to come to Christ, sometimes I pray that something will come, that they may experience something negative that will awaken them. Because sometimes we won't change till something negative happens, something unforeseen in the midst of our life. And then the commitment. And the commitment came, here am I. Who will go for me? Who will go? Who will do that? Here am I, Lord. Here am I. I will do your will. I will follow you. I close with this. Why is it so much that husbands, wives, that commit to each other? I'm thinking about 34 years ago, we made commitments to each other, right, dear? And I remember when Barb said to me, she used the example, Dave, in Ruth that we studied the other night. She said, just as Ruth said, I will go where you go, I will stay, I will do what you do. Barb said, that was our thing. We're in it together. And 34 years, she's still here. I just wonder why, but no. But we made that commitment and promise. And here's the thing. If we make commitments to one another, and we desire to keep that commitment and to love them all through the years, whatever it is, we made that. We're gonna, and it's, sometimes there's some difficult times. Why is it that we don't have the same commitment to our God? That we're willing to trust one another, and I do trust, and Barb trusts me. We have unconditional love. There's, you know, spouses tease one another and different, but we trust one another. And that trust means everything, doesn't it? But if we can trust one another, why can't we trust God? You know, I'm weak. I'm not always consistent. I'm not stable sometimes. But God is faithful, isn't he? God is true. God is ever dependable. And why is it that people will commit to something else but won't commit to God? It baffles me. But I trust today that your commitment will stay true. Don't waver on it. To see God means everything. And one day, we're going to see him. We're going to see Jesus as the sea. And we may not want it right now, but the day will come. Whether through his coming or through the calling, we'll be with him. But what a day that will be. Until then, we serve him and love him. I hope that you see God, and I hope that you have a heart that longs for him. Father, today we pray, dear Father, that even this week, today, this moment, and this week, that Lord, help people to trust you. Help today that some are going to go to the doctor, some may have some tests, they may have things that they're going to face. Lord, help them to trust you. We have our dear young people, it's a difficult time for them moving through just constantly on Zoom or whatever it is, and we know that it's a way, but it causes so much difficulty with the learning. Help our young people to trust you and to be patient through that process. It's not easy. Help each of us to trust you every day, to long to know that you're there. You're upholding our life. You bring stability. Help us not to allow the winds of change to cause us to waver or to have a lessened viewpoint, because you're there for your people. As we sing this closing hymn, help us to cement our trust in you, in your name. Amen. Would you stand with me and join me in our closing hymn? open my eyes that I may see. The first, second, and fourth stanzas. May God, who is our strong tower, who indeed is our righteousness and salvation, and may Jesus Christ, his wonderful grace, rest upon us and help us and hold us. May the Holy Spirit, Lord, who is the one who comes alongside, be alongside us wherever we go this week, and grant us your blessing. In Jesus' name, amen.